Okay, so this is lecture 19. Okay, so the last class we saw quite a few things, and I think there might have been a few things which are quite totally new to you, and maybe you're confused about it. And the only way to get rid of that confusion is to go back and read something more about DSP and spectral factorization and all that. So I'm going to give a little bit of a glimpse into those things once again, real quick, to get you started on that. Okay, so few ideas on spectral factorization before we proceed. Okay, it's actually a very simple thing. It just sounds like a very major result, but it's quite simple. Okay, so typically, when you think of signals, say xn, okay, I'll do it in discrete time. You do a DTFT, you get x of e power j omega, right? And you know how to go back from x of e power j omega to the unique x of t. You know that's unique. Given the magnitude and phase of x of e power j omega, right? You can go back to the magnitude and phase of xn. Okay, so complex to complex is unique. There's no problem there. Okay. So what happens in spectral factorization is you have to imagine that you're given the, what are you given? You're not given x of e power j omega. You're given only the magnitude of x of e power j omega. As in, so what you're given, the way it's described is you're given the Fourier transform of the autocorrelation of x. Okay, suppose I do rx, say rxx of m, and then do its DTFT. What will happen to that? You know, this is going to be, this is what it's going to be. Okay, from here you cannot go back to a unique xn. Is that clear? Right? Clearly, I cannot go back to a unique xn. Okay, so because only the magnitude of x of e power j omega is given, the phase can be arbitrary. I can pick any phase I want. Well, arbitrary according to maybe some conditions. If x of n is real, then the phase has to satisfy some symmetry, etc. But if x of n is in general complex, the phase of x of e power j omega can be anything. Okay, so there are an infinite number of phase responses that you can pick, and you can go back from mod x of e power j omega to mod x of e power j omega to technically an infinite number of x. Okay, so in some cases you might be interested in something more specific than an infinite number of possibilities. Okay, so in that case a good criteria is to select this minimum phase xn. Suppose I want a minimum phase xn, then it turns out there's a unique answer. Okay, so the way I wrote it down, there's a unique answer. That's what I gave you right in yesterday's class. So if you want to go to the minimum phase xn, there is a unique answer. It has to be, right? I mean, put a minimum phase constraint, it's a big constraint, right? So it has to be unique. The way you can derive this in so many different ways, and it has to be unique. It works out to be unique in general. Okay, so that's the basic idea in spectral factorization. Okay, so the way it showed up for us is a little bit different. So it might not have been very obvious that this is what I was doing. So this is the basic idea in spectral factorization. The way it's used in practice might be in so many different ways. Okay, so several times you might have come to x of e power j omega through some other route. Okay, maybe not a minimum phase xn. Okay, which is what happened to us, right? So what did we do? We had h of t. Okay, from h of t we went to the autocorrelation of h, and from there we went to the PSD of h of t, right? So that's how we went. But h of t may not be minimum phase. Okay, so if you want to go back, just given the magnitude response, you might want to go back to the minimum phase thing. And then we saw the advantage of having minimum phase. Okay, so once you split it up as a minimum phase factorization, then you can do a suitable filtering to reduce the ISI to only the causal part. That was a big advantage. For instance, if it is not minimum phase, if it has some zeros and poles outside or things like that, you can't do that filtering very easily. It's not clear how to do that filtering. Okay, once you do the minimum phase factorization, you can take the maximum phase part, do the reciprocal of that, and get a meaningful filter. Once you get a meaningful stable filter, you can run that and then get only the causal part from a minimum phase filter as the ISL. Okay, so that's the idea that seems to make sense, and hopefully there are so many new ideas here. Hopefully some of it is reasonably clear. Okay, so if there's any question, lingering questions, let me write down the structure, then I'll ask you for questions. Okay, so what's happening is you have, so remember this the symbol sequence, I'm thinking of it as actually a vector of length L from the alphabet, but I can also think of it as a discrete time signal, there's no problem. It actually goes through a transmit filter GT, and then after that a channel CT. Okay, together these two I'm going to call as HT. Okay, and then noise gets added. Okay, and I got RT. Okay, so then I wanted to see how can I find S. Okay, one criteria seemed to be maybe a distance criteria based on S. So I defined this JA, which was some kind of a distance between R of T and, well, summation AK H of T minus KT, right? Okay, right? So this was my criteria. In that criteria, filtering by H star of minus T came out naturally. Okay, so I had to find this YK, which is basically a filtering by H star of minus T and then sampling. Okay, it came out in this criteria. Okay, if you had chosen some other criteria, something else might have happened. I don't know. Okay, so but since we chose this criteria, the filtering by H star of minus T happened to occur naturally. Okay, and you sample at symbol rate to get YK. Okay, so this YK we saw can be written in terms of SK in what fashion? It's actually what? SK convolved with rho HK. Okay, so it's not just plus some N prime K. The reason why I'm putting N prime is it's not really white. Okay, it's got some PST. Okay. So notice, how did I get the autocorrelation? It's very crucial. Okay, the reason why I got autocorrelation is because I did a match filtering. Okay, so if I did not do this match filtering here, if this H star was some other filter, say a low pass filter or some such thing, then I won't get a autocorrelation. Okay, so that's crucial. Okay, so the fact that I know H of T to do H star of minus T was crucial to get an autocorrelation. If I chose some other arbitrary filter and sampled, I won't get autocorrelation. I'll get what instead? Maybe cross correlation or some weird signal here. Okay, what's the advantage in getting autocorrelation as opposed to any other signal? Then I can do spectral factorization. So you see how the spectral factorization flew into that picture. So if you did not have spectral factorization and if you only had YK and you had to compute this metric for each A, there's no way you can do with linear computation. It will become L square computation. Maybe there are other cases where it works out, but in general it will be an L square computation, which becomes pretty much impractical to do for any even a fixed A. Okay, so all these things are important steps and they seem to come naturally and quickly when I do it, but when you go back, it won't, should be clear in your head why it's coming through that way. Okay, so how I got YK and why is it that resulted in the autocorrelation and why that results in a PSD, which can be then spectrally factorized. Okay, so what's the big point in spectral factorization? Okay, so before I go there, what are the statistics for this? Okay, it's going to be, it will not be white, okay, but each, so it's going to be Gaussian with PSD what? What will be the PSD? SH of, e power j 2 pi ft if you will. Okay, is that clear? What is SH? That's the Fourier transform of rho h of k. Okay, how did I get that? Okay, it's actually H star of minus T multiplied by H of T itself, right? That works out and you get the PST. Okay, so this N prime K is not white. Okay, that's another issue floating around. Okay, so all these things are there and computing JA with YK itself turned out to be a more complicated problem. Okay, so then you do a substitution. How do you do that substitution? You do it in a weird way. You take the PST, do a spectral factorization and get SH of e power j 2 pi ft as what? E power j 2 pi ft. Okay, well, it has to factor as magnitude square of something, right? How did I pick that specific m? I picked it so that it became gamma square times m of e power j, 2 pi ft times m star of e power j 2 pi ft in addition If you do a DTFT of M of T, you get a M of K, which is minimum phase. Okay, so this is well loosely minimum phase. Okay, well, like I pointed out, if you're given a PSD, you can do this factorization if you don't insist for minimum phase in an infinite variety of way. Okay, so you can obviously, right, the magnitude response is fixed. Once you fix the magnitude response, you can vary the phase in an infinite way and get any signal you want here. But that's not what I picked. I took that one which was minimum phase. Okay, so once I did that, it turns out it's meaningful to, well, I might have written this in the Z transform. In Z transform, if you want to write, it becomes what? SHZ is M squared, gamma squared, M of Z, M star of 1 by Z star. Okay, and if you want to write it in the time domain, what will happen? Rho H of K equals gamma square MK convolved with M star of minus K. Okay, all these things are equivalent ways of writing the minimum phase factorization, spectral factorization, unique minimum phase spectral factorization. Okay, so that uniqueness must have surprised you if it didn't surprise you before. So once you say insist on minimum phase, the factorization becomes unique. Okay, well, it's also a convenience. Okay, any other type of phase also will make it unique. Okay, so it's not a big deal, but still, it's minimum phase has a nice property that, what is the nice property? Most of the energy is going to be concentrated in the first few taps of my MK. Okay, so that we will use later on in our decoder when we filter. Okay, so once we did this, it turned out you take the YK and do what? Remember, how did I get the YK? I took R of T filtered with, sorry, this is R of T filtered with H star of minus T and sampled at KT. I got YK. And then what do? You do this filtering by 1 by gamma square M star of e power j 2 pi ft. Okay, you do this filtering. Seems a little strange, but you do the filtering, you get zk. The reason why this filter makes sense and works is, I know it's going to be the denominator, I have everything works out, right? So that's the basic idea. Okay, is that clear why this works out? Okay, so think about it. Okay, so you get a zk, and then in terms of zk, things become really, really easy. Okay, so once you write it in terms of zk, it turns out this ja becomes equivalent to another metric which I called j prime a, which was what? Norm of, okay, so let me not write norm, I'll just happily write down. What did I mean? I think I put a summation, right? Did I have a summation? Summation k equals 0 to infinity. Did I have 0 to infinity? Okay. It will be modulus zk minus what? Ak convolved with mk square. Okay, norm squared. There's a norm squared. Maybe it's not showing up properly in the. Okay, so maybe I should move this guy. Okay. Oops, this thing didn't move. Okay, so more than this filter being anything implementable or worrying about, that those are not the big deal. That's not the big deal. The big deal was, because I did this filtering, my JA, the metric became much simpler than before. That is the big deal. Okay, so forget about this filter and its properties. It may or may not have any of the properties I said. I don't care. But because I did that special substitution with the minimum phase M of Z, or this filtering with the minimum phase M, it became the JA simplified to this. Okay, you can go back and check it and use the way I did that. The minimum phase assumption is crucial there. Otherwise, it won't work so nicely. Okay, so at least I believe that's what should happen. Okay, so those are things you can check. Okay, so this is very nice to see. Okay, So not only that, there is one more thing that's nicely happens. What is the next thing that happens? Okay. What happens to ZK if you want to write it in terms of SK? It's going to be SK convolved with MK plus NK. Now what is NK now? It's going to be white. Okay, so that's a big advantage. Normal zero variance N0 by 2 gamma square. Okay, so that's a simple derivation to do. Okay, so once again you multiply, you see SH of Z on the top, the denominator you have M star, but then if you do the M star times M, you once again get the SH and you'll have an extra gamma square floating around. Okay, right? You have a gamma square in the denominator. You might say, why did I put the gamma square? Maybe I don't want the gamma square. It's okay. Those are all constants which don't matter at the end. Okay, so you put the gamma square there, you get this guy. Okay, so several nice things happen when I do this filtering. Okay, so you have to go back and ask yourself very closely the question of why the spectral factorization is crucial. Why can't I take some other, instead of MK, what if I take some other factorization with some other phase, necessarily not minimum phase. Okay, so maybe most of these things you can repeat. Okay, but the biggest advantage which you'll never have is most of the energy being concentrated in the first few taps. Okay, then you can eventually approximate M with only its first few taps, and you'll see the first few taps will make a big difference to your complexity as we go along. Okay, so maybe the crucial statement is in the minimum phase thing is most of the energy is concentrated in the first few taps. Most of the other steps you might be able to repeat with any other factorization. Okay, so it may not be a big deal, but this crucial step of most of the energy being concentrated in the first few taps comes pretty much because of the minimum phase criteria. But anyway, go back and check those things and make sure you understand where exactly this minimum unique thing is coming in, what are all the roles it's playing. Okay, alright, so any questions? It's fine. People are happy with this picture. Okay, so now based on this, I was able to draw a nice picture of the entire receiver, at least for the calculation of this J prime A. Okay, so what did I do? I took the ZK. Okay, remember, should remember how I got the ZK. Okay, so I got the ZK through from R of T, filter with H star of minus T, sample at symbol rate, and then 1 by gamma square M star of 1 by Z star. Okay, so you do that, you get ZK. And then what do? In computing, J A prime. Okay, so well, let me do it differently. Okay, it's quite easy. You send it through a summer difference with what? You send your AK through MK or M of Z, capital M of Z, right? You get a certain thing, subtract out here, and then you do what? You sum square. You will get your J prime A. Okay, so in reality, in practice, if you want to implement anything like this, one of the things you have to struggle with is delays. Okay, so delay will never be obvious. Okay, ZK is coming through so many steps in your filtering. There are so many delays that will be caused. You might have delayed your cost for causality, you might have delayed your transmit filter for causality, you might have to even delay your 1 by gamma square. I don't know how you will implement your 1 by gamma square M star 1 by Z star. So that might have been one more crazy implementation. So at the end, there will be all kinds of delays. Okay, and you have to adjust for the delay properly if this J A prime has to make any sense. Okay, otherwise, it will be something else. Okay, and you will be measuring something else. And you have no business doing such things. Okay, so I'm sure people who are doing the lab realize how important this delay and adjustment is. Measure at different points, you get completely different things, which doesn't make any sense. Okay. So be very careful about delay when you, if at all you're trying to implement such things in practice. All right. So you do this, you get J A prime. So now I have a nice expression that I wrote down for my decoder. I'm going to minimize over all A J A prime. Okay. Right. So maybe the computation of J A prime is doable for one A. But that's not where my problem ends. Okay, so that's where my problem pretty much begins, right? So I have to then compute J A prime for each A, and I have too many of those A's. Okay, so the number of such A's is size of x to the power L, and that's one too many. Okay, so for any kind of reasonable L you want and reasonable size of x, even if it is 2, 2 power L is too fastly growing in L, you can't hope to do anything better than that. Okay, so that problem still remains to be solved. Okay, so we have not solved that problem yet, and it turns out there is a wonderful algorithm called the Viterbi algorithm which will solve that problem and make it still linearly grow with L, assuming your MK is doesn't have too many taps. Okay, so we can do that, at least as a finite number of taps. Okay, it's possible to solve that problem. We'll come to it later, but before that I want to do this neat and clean orthogonal projection and find an orthogonal basis for our set of signals and see that we pretty much recover the same structure that we have now. Okay, so we'll see the relationship between the two of them and then proceed along. Okay, so after at that point I'll make some general comments of what to do as we go along, and then we'll stop there. Okay, so any questions right now? Okay, so the question is basically you're saying, you're coming at this picture and saying, why don't you first do a C inverse of T? Okay, so the problem is, okay, so I have to make a few comments. I thought I'll make the comments after I show the orthogonal projection, but even now it's a good time. Okay, so any filtering you do at the receiver, it'll be nice if only the signal part went in through that and the noise part didn't go through that. Okay, so but you can't control that. Okay, so the noise will also go through that same filter. Okay, and C inverse of T may not be a good filter. It might boost up your noise variance to a great level. Okay, and that's something you may not want. Okay, so what you really want to do optimally is what? Do an orthogonal projection. If you know the orthogonal projection, you know that's going to be optimal. Okay, so you go to the signal space, find an orthogonal basis, do an orthogonal projection. That is the best thing to do. Okay, which is what I'm going to do now. Okay, anything else you do, like C inverse of T for instance, is a heuristic. Like including this minimum distance is also a heuristic right now. Okay, it's a heuristic. It may or may not give you the best probability of error. Okay, but that's definitely doable and it's done. Okay, a lot of people do this. It's called a linear equalization type. So you do a C inverse of T, get rid of it, and then continue with your G of T. It can be done in practice. Maybe it's a good choice, but it may need not be the ideal thing. Okay. Okay, any other question? Any other question? Okay, so in practice also this kind of a structure where you do two stages of equalization, one stage for getting rid of the anticausal ISI and another stage for getting rid of the causal ISI can be shown to be very good, as in even theoretically one can show that can approach capacity. So those kind of constructions are usually preferred for that reason. Okay, but you can also do the C inverse of T. It's okay. Alright, so the next thing I want to do is this orthonormal basis projection. Let's figure out. Okay, so I'll try to do this and make some comments, and then maybe we'll see how we are doing. Okay, alright, So what's our set of signals and what's an orthonormal basis for the signals? Okay, so what you'll see is it's very interesting. Okay, so what is our set of signals? Okay, set of signals at transmitter. Okay, does it make sense to talk about set of signals at transmitter? Okay, I should never talk about set of signals at transmitter, right? So I should not do orthogonal projection on that. What should I do? At the receiver, the signal component at the receiver, for that I have to do the orthogonal projection. Okay, so always remember that I have to look at set of signals at the receiver or in R of T. These are summation k equals 0 to L minus 1 ak h of t minus kt. Okay, for a in xl. Okay, these are my set of signals. How many signals do I have? Size x to the power L. Okay, I have a lot of them. Now, I want to find an orthonormal basis for this set of signals. Once I find it, then I know the optimal thing to do is to project onto that orthonormal basis and then do a minimum distance receive. Okay, so if I do the orthonormal basis projection, I also know that my noise is going to be just n naught by 2 and all that. I know all those things, so it's very nice to do that. Okay, so it's optimal in various ways, and this will be the optimal receiver. Okay, so here's a claim. okay, which is an interesting claim, and you'll see where it comes from. Okay, suppose I take this h of t. Okay, let me write down a few properties for this h of t. I'll come to the claim slow enough. Maybe its Fourier transform is HF. Okay, I'll let that be so. And then I also want to do a few things before I'm able to define the orthonormal basis. Okay, h of t convolved with h star of minus t. Okay, if I do a Fourier transform, what will I get? Mod HF squared. Okay, then if I sample this h of t convolved with h star of minus t at kt, what will I get? If I do a dt of t, what will I get? It will alias, no? I'll do a 1 by t aliasing. So 1 by t summation m equals minus infinity to infinity mod h of f minus m by t squared. Okay, so this I will call sh e power j 2 pi f t. Okay, so that will be my aliasing. Okay, so I'll take this sh e power j 2 pi f t. I'll do a speckle factorization on it. I know it's real and non-negative. So speckle factorization will give me a unique m of e power j 2 pi f t. Same as before. I mean, there's nothing new here. J 2 pi f t is gamma squared m of e power j 2 pi f t m star e power j 2 pi. Okay, so this is spectral factorization. All right. Okay, so I have all my notation and tools to define the orthonormal basis. Okay, so first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to define a phi t, which is the Fourier transform, which is the inverse Fourier transform of phi f, which is defined to be h of f divided by gamma m e power j 2 pi f t. So I'm wondering if there should be an m star or m. Let me just check if I'm contradicting myself somewhere. Okay, it's only m. Okay. Okay, so this operation is clearly well defined. I take h of f and divide by gamma m of e power j 2 pi f t. Okay, right. So there's all kinds of interesting interplay between discrete time and continuous time here. Okay, so hopefully all that is clear. Okay, so you can think of the denominator as the Fourier transform it's a periodic Fourier transform, right? So it's a properly well-defined division. There's nothing confusing there. But on the top, you now don't have sh of e power j 2 pi of t. If you did, you would only get m star of e power j 2 pi of t. Now you have simply h of f itself, okay, which is actually a Fourier transform. It's not a discrete time thing, okay? But still, I can adjust my axis so that both of these will match, and then I can divide, okay? So it works out, all right? So make sure you get a feel for the intricacies here. Okay, so here's the claim. Okay, the claim is the following. Suppose I define a linear space S as the span of h of t minus kt. What do I mean by span of h of t minus kt? Basically, all the signals that I had will belong to this, and you do the same thing. Okay, so summation, basically signals of the form summation sk h of t minus kt. Okay, k equals for all over k. Okay, you can put, so it's a span of the shifted versions of h of t. Okay, so I'm not guaranteed that h of t minus kt is an orthonormal basis. Okay, I'm not guaranteed. Okay, so what I'm guaranteed on the other hand is that phi of t minus kt is an orthonormal basis for S. Okay, so that's where the interesting result comes through. Okay, so h of t minus kt need not be orthonormal But phi, if you define it this way, phi of t minus kt becomes an orthonormal basis for h of t. Any questions? It's okay. People are happy. How many of you can prove this? Okay, so think about proving it. So what's the way to prove it? How do you show a set of vectors or entities is orthonormal? How do you do it? Yeah, so you have to compute the inner product and show it goes to 0 if there is a non-zero shift, and it becomes 1 if there is no shift. And also, yeah, also that it spans. Okay, so that's also an important thing, that I should show that this vector spans the entire space that's spanned by h of t minus kt. So once I prove those two steps, then I'm done. Okay, so I'll prove the first step, that the inner product is goes to 0. Okay. All right. So how do I show that? So basically, I have to write down what is the inner product, minus infinity to infinity, phi of t, phi star of t minus kt. Okay, I have to try to evaluate this inner product. But once again, I'll use this way of evaluating inner products, which is what? I will see that this is actually phi of t convolved with phi star of minus t, which is sampled at kt. Okay, so this allows me to use my knowledge of Fourier transforms and all that. Okay, so if I do a Fourier transform here, what will I get? If I do a DTFT on this, I will get 1 by t summation m equals minus infinity to infinity modulus phi of f minus m by t square. Is there a question? Okay. So the way the proof is what? For each k, I'm not showing it is 0. Okay, I'm looking at the entire sequence. For all k, I look at the sequence and I'm going to show that entire sequence is equal to a delta. Okay, that's what I'm showing. Both of them are the same. Okay, so for each non-zero k, I'm showing 0. I'm showing the entire sequence is delta. If the entire sequence is delta, what should happen to its DTFT? It should become 1. So basically, I have to show that this DTFT is going to become 1. Okay, once I show that this DTFT is 1, I know that this sequence for all k is going to become a delta, which is what I want to show. Okay, so that's the way in which the proof will go. And to show that this thing is 1 is very trivial. Okay, so it's not a big deal. You just go back and look at that formula. You'll get 1 by t summation m equals minus infinity to infinity. Okay, so what did you get there? Modulus h of f minus m by t squared, right? In the denominator, you would have gamma squared. Okay, gamma squared times what? Modulus m of e power j 2 pi f minus m by t times t squared. Do you get that? Okay, that's all. Okay, so the denominator now conveniently becomes independent of m. Okay, why is that? Okay, it will become, okay, you multiply through, you get e power j 2 pi of t times something which is 1. Okay, so it goes away, e power j 2 pi m, and I can ignore that. Okay, so I can pull that out. Okay, so what do I get? 1 by gamma squared mod m of e power j 2 pi of t squared times 1 by t summation m equals minus infinity to infinity modulus h of f minus m by t squared. Okay, so numerator and denominator, this both of these are exactly different ways of writing sh of e power j 2 pi of t. Do you notice that? Okay, here I have written mod square, but what is this? What is this guy? It's m times m star, so it's also mod square only. Okay, so it's the same thing. So you notice, I can write this as, this k becomes fh of e power j 2 pi of t. This is also what? The same thing. Both of them will cancel and you will get 1. Okay. So what I have shown is that the DTFT of my inner product sequence is 1, which means the inner product sequence itself is a delta, and phi of t minus kt is orthonormal. Okay, there's no problem here. Okay, so I want you to go back and carefully check at what point I use the fact that m is minimum phase. go back and look at the derivation and tell me if I can repeat the same derivation with any other m which was not minimum phase. Any other way of factoring sh of e power j 2 pi ft. Can I do that? Will I still get an orthonormal basis? At what point did I use the fact that m was minimum phase? I'm sorry? No, but gamma square is just a convenience. Forget about gamma square. No, I can just integrate gamma into the m and write sh of e power j 2 pi ft as some a of e power j 2 pi ft times a star of e power j 2 pi ft, and then divide define phi of t as the Fourier transform of phi of f, which is h of f divided by a of f. A of e power j 2 pi ft. If I did that also, will I get phi of t to be an orthonormal set in the translation? Looks like I should, right? I'm not doing anything there. Okay, there's nothing holy about the minimum phase. Okay, so keep asking your question over and over again. Okay, don't just because I write down something, don't say think that that's the only way of doing things. Okay, so in fact, if I chose the simple factorization h of f times h star of f also, what will happen? Will it work? Okay, what will happen if I did that? Okay, then it may not work. I don't know. Okay, so you have to worry so much about several things. Pay attention to what you're doing. What will happen if you did that? I would have got phi of f as 1 for all f, which would mean phi of t became delta of t. Okay, well, yeah, delta of t minus kt. You can think of it as orthonormal basis if you want. But it'll be of no use to you. Okay, so there might be problems later on. The second step is also equally crucial. Okay, so what's the second step? Okay, the first step seems to be okay. Okay, there seems to be several choices, and we picked one choice, and we showed it was orthonormal. There's no problem. What's the second step? The spanning step. I have to show that I can obtain any signal that I had before by a linear combination of phi of t minus kt. Right, my signal space is what? Summation all linear combinations of h of t minus kt. I have to now show that the phi of t minus kt, doing linear combinations on that, I can get any linear combination of h of t minus kt. How do I show that? Think about it for a few minutes. See if you can come up with some equations which tell you that it's always possible. So what's the problem? The problem is, suppose I have, so this is for spanning. Okay, suppose I have an S of t which is summation sk h of t minus kt. Okay, how do I write this S of t as summation bk phi of t minus kt? Can I write it? Okay, if I can write it, then I know that it spans. But can I write it is the question. How do you go about doing it? But I don't want energy. No, I want to be able to exactly write it. I have to find s of t at each t as a linear combination of phi of t minus and kt. No, you mean you give me the bk, I think. Let me not be. So I have to show that there exists bk such that s of t is summation bk phi of t minus kt. In fact, you can explicitly construct a bk. Okay, what is that bk? Okay, so the confusing thing is the interplay between continuous time and discrete time. So how you're sampling here and actually you're getting a discrete time filter and continuous time filter, It's not very easy to quickly deal with it. Okay, so one way of doing it is to do a picture to just see at least what the complication really is. Okay, so you have SK, which you're thinking as a discrete time signal, and then I suddenly put a HT, and then what do I get? Another continuous time signal. Okay, to keep everything consistent, let me make everything continuous time. In that case, what does SK actually become? Summation SK delta T minus KT. Do you see that? If I think of it that way, then here I get ST. Okay, so that is fine. This is a picture. Okay, so now I know HF is what? Phi of F divided by gamma M of e power j 2 pi FT. Is that the way I defined it? Oh, phi F is on the left side. I'm sorry. Yeah, it has to be on the left side. Is that fine? Okay, so this is how I defined it. So now I have to be careful when I keep taking. See, I don't want to take inverse Fourier transform of m of e power j 2 pi ft. Okay, I can take it. What will I get if I take an inverse Fourier transform of m of g e power j 2 pi ft? Impulse train, right? Why will I get an impulse train? Because it is a periodic Fourier transform. Okay, what will that impulse train be? Some impulse train with certain weights. Okay, that will be mk, right? It will be an impulse train with weight mk. Okay, so that's the way to go back to continuous time. If I want to go back to time picture here, I can say h of t equals phi of t convolved with what? An impulse train defined by, well, there is a gamma, don't forget the gamma, mk delta t minus kt. Okay, well, it's getting ugly, so let me rewrite it. Okay, so one needs to be careful about these impulse trains, not to get too carried away and start differentiating or anything, but as long as we write the equations like this, it's okay. It will be valid. Okay, do you see that? That's a periodic Fourier transform, and it will convert back an inverse Fourier transform to an impulse train. That impulse train is given by the DTFT if you freeze it down to one location. It's all the same. The Fourier series and all these things are exactly matched here. There's no problem. Okay, so once I do this, I'm done. Right? Am I done? Yeah, I'm really done. So all I have to do is take SK and filter it in discrete time if I want, even with MK, which is what is happening in the first step, and then do what? Well, multiply by gamma. Okay, so multiplication by gamma is always there. So maybe I filter with gamma MK. Okay, and then I do phi T here, and I would get ST again. Okay, so if I call this guy here BK, I can write my ST as summation BK phi of T minus KT, and BK would turn out to be gamma times SK convolved with MK. Is that fine? So I have shown my spanning property, which worked out in a very simple way. Okay. So now, the next question, what is the question I'm going to ask? At what point in this proof did I use the fact that MK is minimum phase? It might be a trick question, I may not have used also. So where did I use it? If I replace the denominator there with any other A of e power j 2 pi ft, as long as it has a proper inverse discrete Fourier transform, should it work? Is it fine? Do you see anything that is disturbing you there? Okay, should work, right? That's what it seems like. Maybe there is something between the lines which is not very clear to me, but it seems to work. I mean, there's no reason why the denominator should be minimum phase. Okay, maybe if it's minimum phase, is there a point? Yeah. Yeah, but still the integrals and all will work. Okay, so loosely minimum phase is not the problem. But in the definition of phi f, if you want phi f to be stable, maybe you want the zeros of the denominator to lie inside the unit circle. But being minimum phase is more strict than that. You also want the poles. Okay. So at least there is some justification for that. Okay, in terms of stability. So this whole minimum phase thing is more for stability and those kind of things as opposed to the requirement of orthonormality itself. Okay, so that's something to keep in mind. And minimum phase also is good because later on, if you want to approximate the response by only the first few taps, then minimum phase helps you because you know that's the best. Okay, so you might as well pick the minimum phase. So the utility of minimum phase is in a different sense as opposed to giving the basic orthonormality. Okay, basic orthonormality seems to come pretty much for free if you take anything. But if you want stability for your filters and all that, then you should need to do this. Okay. Alright, so this seems fairly clean. Okay, so now I want to show some kind of an equivalence between the distance criteria we had before and the optimal criteria. Okay, so if you want to run an optimal receiver, what should you do to R of T? Okay, what should you do? You filter with, I'm sorry, phi star of minus T. Okay, so you do that, you get your optimal filter. And then sample at symbol rate KT. Okay, well, you're not done doing optimal stuff. Okay, so, okay, for instance, will you have ISI now? You will have ISI. Okay, don't imagine there'll be no ISI. Okay, phi of T need not satisfy the Nyquist criteria. It would be great if it did. Okay, if it satisfied that, it would be great. Okay, well, not necessarily phi of T. You probably need some weird combination. I don't know how it's going to work out. Okay, maybe there is some Nyquist criteria possible here so that you got no ISI. But in general, there will be ISI. So your detection problem is not yet solved, but you'll still be optimal. I mean, you're not going to lose any information. You're not losing any information in the orthonormal projection. Okay, so what you get here will be what? Okay, so ZK, so I don't want to call it ZK because there is some constant missing. I'll call it Z prime K, which is going to be what? Gamma times SK convolved with MK plus NK, and my noise now will be normal with mean 0 and variance N0 by 2. It will also be white Gaussian. Okay. Okay, this is completely compatible with the previous picture because there we multiplied everything, divided everything by gamma. Okay, so it's the same thing. It's not in any way different. Just the gamma has gone to something else. Okay, don't be suddenly disturbed by the factor it has. But clearly you have ISI. Okay, Z prime of K, it doesn't depend exactly on one SK, but it depends on several SKs. It's SK convolved with MK, which was your minimum phase spectral factorization, or for that matter any other spectral factorization, but some fact related to the spectral factorization of SH. Okay, so that's how it worked out. All right, so now you have the most important task of running this through the detector, some detector which we don't know how to build at. Okay, we don't know how to efficiently build this detector, but we know how to build it brute force. How will you build it brute force? Right? What do you do? You run through all possibilities and find the minimum distance one. Okay? So remember, now your transmit constellation was very nice. Okay? What's happening to your receive constellation if you just look at Z prime? All kinds of things will happen, right? You're doing filtering with MK for arbitrary sequences. So your receive constellation will be very strange. Okay? One doesn't know how to do detection there. Okay? But if you do exhaustive computation and then do minimum distance criteria, you should get the answer because after all you're in white Gaussian noise, so there's nothing more complicated than that. Okay, so in theory the detector is already given, just do minimum distance, you'll get it. Okay, but in practice we might have to do more things. Okay, so that's where the Viterbi algorithm comes in. Okay, so before we close up this, there's a quick 1 minute I want to take to show you the equivalence between this orthogonal projection and the H star of minus T sampled followed by 1 by gamma square m star of z star. It's very easy to see actually. Okay, so it's not a big deal. What is phi star of minus t? If you do a Fourier transform, what do you get? H star of f divided by gamma m star of e power j 2 pi f t. Okay, that's enough. I can pretty much stop there. Okay, what did I do in the previous case? I took R of t, I first filtered with h star of f, whose impulse response is h star of minus t. Okay, but then I sampled immediately and then filtered with 1 by gamma, well, gamma squared m star of 1 by z star. Okay, but that's okay. I can sample either before or after because I know the denominator here is actually a discrete time filter. So I can either sample before that or after that. I won't lose any optimality. Okay, so that's the way in which to quickly see the equivalence between this and that picture we have. Okay, so what's the final selling point here? So you can reduce systems with ISI to by orthogonal projection if you know h of t. Okay, if you know h of t, you can do the minimum phase factorization and in fact get in some way the least possible ISI into your system. Okay, when you do minimum phase, you will get the least possible ISI into your system, right? Because almost all your ISI is concentrated in the first few tabs, only the first few symbols will affect you. Everything else will not affect you too much. But still, unless there are some special Nyquist criteria satisfied by a combination of things by sheer luck, you will not be able to completely eliminate ISI. Okay, so later on we'll see some fancy multi-carrier modulation methods where people still eliminate ISI. But there again the Nyquist criteria will be satisfied in some way. Okay, so it's possible to do that, but then you'll have to do multi-carrier stuff, okay, which is more complicated. With a single carrier, it's clearly not possible in the general case. Okay, so but it's possible to minimize the ISI to the least possible effect, and then you do something else like the Viterbi tutorial. Okay, so before we close today, okay, maybe I'll make these comments on Monday. More comments on this and how practical this h star of minus t and all is, we'll make Monday.